नास्ता धर्मे न बोसुनी चाहिए नैव काम उपभोगे यद्भाव्यम तद्भवतु भगवान पूर्व कर्मानुरूपम एतत् प्रार्थ्यं मम बहुमतं जन्म जन्मांतरे उपि तत्पादं वरुहो जुगगता निश्चला भक्तिरस्तु Lord, I do not care for so-called meritorious acts, neither for wealth nor for enjoyment of the objects of desire. Let that which is inevitable fall to my life according to my previous karma. But this is my cherished desire, that I should be endowed with love unshaken for thy lotus feet in this life. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Peace, peace, peace be unto all. This morning my subject is Stories of Vedanta Monks, Part 10. In my last lecture, Vedanta Stories, Part 9, I talked about the life of Swami Bhuteshananda, the 12th president of the Ramakrishna Order. He was a remarkable man. He had a deep impression in my mind. I knew him from 1960 to 1998, 38 years. Of course, up and on, I did not live with him for a long time. But I came across to a real, real, genuine monk. Flawless character. Sometimes we try to evaluate monks comparing the signs of the scriptures. In the 12th chapter of the Gita, Krishna mentioned the signs of a great devotee. Advishta sarvabhutanam. He has no enemies in this world. Maitra Kuruna Evacha, full of love, friendship, and compassion. And his mind dwells in God. And he is ever contented. Santushta Satatam Yogi, Jatatma, self-control, Dhidanisha, firm conviction about spiritual life. And free from attachment, even minded in happiness and misery. A great monk. Full of renunciation, as I told you, full of. He was a great scholar. Fantastic memory. But he was not a very good-looking person. The big, dark complexion. Sometimes he used to say that, you know, I am not very good-looking, still people come to see me. I used to tell Maharaj, you are a guru, so for that reason they come to see you. Sometimes God plays in a very mysterious way. Sometimes we might have a very good look, but you might not have any good qualities. Sometimes you know not good intelligence. Sometimes you may look ugly, but you have tremendous intelligence and all good qualities. Sometimes we see some people extremely learned but very poor. Sometimes we see very poor but extremely, you know, very rich. So sometimes it seems that God plays with his children. I shall give you beauty, but not intelligence. I shall give you learning, but poverty. He plays. Do you know why? If he gives all good things to us, perhaps we shall not be able to handle it. We'll be very egotistic. So God curbs our egos. I was thinking about it when I was thinking about his physical beauty. He was a wonderful storyteller. And sometimes he used to teach through humor. A devotee came and asked, Maharaj, I have some big problems. Problems? God has even problems. Then people are inquired, God has problems? Of course he has. Krishna, Vishnu became Jagannath, wooden image with no hands. He has problems. But what is his problems? He has two wives, Lakshmi and Saraswati. Lakshmi is the goddess of learning, but very restless. Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth, but very restless. But Saraswati is the goddess of learning, but extremely quarrelsome. If you have these two wives, you can imagine what is your condition. Moreover, his son, Kandarpa, is always fighting, worldly, mad, disobedient. He has no peace at home. So he took rest in the ocean, lying down on the Vasuki, this thousand-hooded snake. It is a mythological story. Thousand-hooded snake. But do you know who is his carrier? Garuda, who is the enemy of the snake. So, Krishna, God was thinking that if Garuda attacks Vasuki, I shall fall into the ocean. For that reason, thinking out of fear, he became like a wood. That is the reason you find the image of Jagannath. He was making a joke about how God has also problems. Then he mentioned, Swamiji says, we are the children of immortal bliss. But I see gloomy, grouchy, somber faces. Why? Why are we so miserable in this world? Why do we not get joy? But if there is a way, you can get joy. Give up desire, worldly desires, you will be happy. Then he talked about, in this world, he was talking about human problems. Everything is relative. Happiness, misery is relative. You have a little leg pain, but you can see a person who does not have any leg. You should not be unhappy that you have a little leg pain, this and that. Seeing this, comparing others, we see we are happy. Then he mentioned, even sound, there's a relative sound. Suppose early in the morning, dong, a bell rang. What? Meditation, bell. Shh, I have to go to meditation. Then dong, breakfast bell came. Oh, then we immediately go to the breakfast table. Dong, work bell came. Shh, again I have to work. When dinner bell comes, again, we are happy. We go to the dinner. He was talking, the same sound is bringing happiness sometimes, sometimes misery. Same sound. In this world, everything is relative. We learned from Swami's life. He was very spiritual, again, full of fun. He was a man of bliss, tasted it and distributed through his life and message. He was born in 1900, passed away in 1998. Very balanced life. practiced all four yogas. He has a motherly heart. But then I never saw him angry. Even if he tells something, but tremendous control of his speech and voice. He conquered the hearts through his love. That is my introduction. Now I shall tell you my reminiscences. You will enjoy it, I hope. I first met him 14th June 1960, it is from my diary. After night, after our supper, there would be a class. 15, 20 minutes, there would be reading. Then the Swami used to tell us his reminiscences of the olden days, how he lived with the Jari disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. Those are all fascinating stories. But I went to Swami Turiyananda in Balaram's house. I saw embodiment of purity and renunciation. He experimented Bhagavad Gita in his life. He used to sit straight, neck straight. I never saw him bent like this. And he told me, the goal of human life is to there is no other purpose in this world than to practice austerity and to realize God. Then he says that he found a mistake in the printing of Udbodhan publication. In the stage of twang, it becomes tong. He became very disturbed. You know, people will think that some illiterate people have joined the Ramakrishna order. You must be very careful. Everything must be correct. 15th June 1960. He talked about his guru. He was a very soft-hearted person. And he used to give refuge to everybody. The monks who could not get along with other centers, they used to come and stay with him. He used to always encourage people to do something. He stayed in the mother's house like Holy Mother's gatekeeper. Then he told about Swami Sivananda. A devotee got initiation and the woman and then said, is it initiation? Swami looked at her and said, come tomorrow. The moment she came next day, Swami gave her spiritual experience. Perhaps she had the vision of God. Then he talked about 16th June 1960. He talked about Swami Shuddhananda, a disciple of Swami Vivekananda, who pulled Swamiji's horse carriage when he was a student in 1897. He wanted to be a monk, but his father locked him at home. He was waiting. When the person brought food, that time he ran away from the room and came to the monastery. Then he was asked that, why did you put on this ochre cloth? He said, everybody will have to leave this world one day. So if I stay in family life, it would be very difficult to detach myself from the earthly ties and attachments. That is the reason I made myself ready, so that any moment I can leave this world. He was a great learned scholar. On 17 June, he told about his days in Uttarkashi in the Himalayas, how he practiced austerity and met various kinds of monks. He used to make joke with those monks. But some monks are very good. Dhani sadhu, meditating. Some babu sadhu. Babu sadhu meaning he must have a wristwatch and a transistor radio. Practicing austerity in the Himalayas. Babu sadhu. I am one of them, you see. I have watched. There are some politician monks. But I saw in the path of the Koilas, two monks are fighting. One monk pushed another monk into the water. But sometimes I saw Durudhi Shadu. Durudhi Shadu means if a monk is suffering from cold, he will give his own blanket and save the other monk's life. I saw mad monks, I saw learned monks. I saw all kinds of monks in the Himalayas. Then he wanted to go back to Belur Mutt. So what I did, I hid his shoes. So when he dressed himself and he was looking for his shoes, where is my shoe? I said, Maharaj, if we find out where those shoes are, hey, you bring my shoes. Uncle Maharaj, you will go tomorrow. So again, he agreed. Next day, what we did? I did. I took his cloth and his t-shirt and put into the soaked water. You see, in India, how we wash our clothes, here's a bucket, hot water, we put soap and some soda, some detergent, and we soaked it. And then after a few hours, we thrash it, and that is where we wash our clothes. And once you make it wet, that day you cannot go, because it will be sun dry, you see, it will take time. It is not America that all be, you know, within 1 hour, your clothes will be ready, not in India. Anyhow, so they say, you are very naughty, you won't let me go, because we love to hear him. Tumi bodo dushtu. He was the in charge of the Rajkot, Ramakrishna Ashram. He wrote me beautiful letters that what is the goal of our life. Our ideal, Sri Ramakrishna and Swamiji, we'll have to follow their path. I still remember, it was in 1961, he came. And he has sore throat, cannot talk properly, and our head Swami requested him to give a talk on Sunday in our chapel. So I was helping him. You bring some hot water with a little salt so that I can gargle and can make my throat ready so that I can speak in the evening. My goodness, 5-6 times I had to carry hot water in his room. To him, master's work is worship. How to worship God through action. Amazing person. Then another funny scene I still remember. A devotee brought some t-shirts, a box of t-shirts. So another Swami, he was Makhan Maharaj Swami Pragyananda, he was the head of the Konkal Center. They say, hey, Bijoy, his pre-monastic name, you have many rich devotees. I shall take some of the t-shirts. Mm-hmm. So he took some t-shirts. And Swami Bhuteshananda says, well, our center is very poor. And we live on alms, on charity. But all centers are poor. Monks do not earn money. So two Swamis are pulling t-shirts each other. One is mother's disciple, another is Swami Sharadananda's disciple. And both are very miserly. I still remember, just like children, you know. Then one of his devotees came, and then I was teasing that devotee. They are from Gujarat. You know, you have come to see a holy man, but you did not bring gatiya and sweets. She smiled. Next day, big boxes of gatiya and sweets she brought. I said, you have come to see a holy man empty-handed? She smiled. In 1970, we went to the dedication ceremony of the Vivekananda Polyclinic in Lucknow. We are 152 monks are there. And Swami Bhuteshananda was then assistant secretary. He also came. Then Swami Sridharananda arranged our visit to Ayodhya, birthplace of Rama, Brahmavarta in Kanpur, and Naimisharanya in Sitapur district, where Vyasa wrote the Bhagavatam. So we went there to Ayodhya. Do you know what happened? We went to see the temple with three deluxe luxury buses, all these monks. And our food packets are there. Some monkeys entered the bus and ruined a lot of foods. And when we came back, we saw that our foods are not there. So anyhow, it was a very... I saw that monk very unperturbed. Whatever comes late, we shall eat, we shall adjust. Whatever unbroken, undisturbed packages, we shall distribute. Anyhow, we managed. But still I remember, such a senior monk, calm, serene, unperturbed. Then we came to Banaras. I said, Maharaj, will you give me 4 pies so that I shall buy some peanut? I can give you 4 pies on condition you will have to return. And then I don't want your money. Then he says, don't you know I am very frugal, miserly. I do not give money to anybody without any specific purpose, you know. Then he says, he was telling his own story that how miserly he was. Well, once 2 monks wanted to eat some betel nut, betel roll. So I gave a 10 rupees note and he went to the shopkeeper. She said, I cannot have any change. Then there are 2 monks said, hey, don't you know whose money is that? It is some Bhuteshananda's money. It does not want to break. Return the 10 rupee note. Well, taka bhangte chai na. He was making joke out of his own. That is a climax in humor, you know. Then in 1971, on Swamiji's birthday, I was asked to come to Hollywood. Then he told me, I shall teach you table manner. You come to my room during breakfast. So I went to his room. Small 2 pieces of toast, a little jelly, 1 Singapore banana, green, tasteless banana. And he got 1 sandesh paras from the temple and 1 cup of tea. Then he gave a talk on table manner. What I still remember, that how to make people own. Look, it is human love that brings people together. Intellect, as Swamiji says, 1/3, 2/3 heart. That is the way it goes. Love people, serve people. Then people be your own. Don't be selfish. I told him, Maharaj, you are sending me to America. Do you know what I shall do? I shall start hippie movement. I shall be an American Ramakrishna hippie. What will you do? Then he smiled. I'll be a Ramakrishna hippie in America. Then in 1977, I visited India from Hollywood. That was my first visit. I went to Amarnath, Kedarnath, Bodrinath. Then I said, Maharaj, I am going to Pushupatinath in Nepal. Will you go? If you pay my travel, you know, my traveling expenses, I shall come. Uncle, all right, I shall pay. But what about my attendant? Uncle, I shall be your attendant. No, no, it does not look good that you will be my attendant. Uncle, all right, I shall pay for him. Then we saw the Nepal Maharaja's secretary, at that time Maharaja was there, was our host. And arranged, and we are all VIPs, fancy cars, showed all over Nepal. Then, I still remember, we went to see a temple quite a distance from Kathmandu. On our way back, car broke down. It is a mountain, up and down. It was 8, 9 o'clock at night, very cold, wind was blowing. What to do? Not too many cars there. Then we saw a truck was coming, so we raised our hand. So stopped the truck, and our guide, I do not know Nepali language, so our guide told him, they said, yes, we shall take you to the city, quite a distance from the town. So Maharaj was quite heavy, so myself and Shikharesh, we both lifted him up and put him next to the driver's seat. You know, Indian trucks are quite high, you know. So put him in there, and we sat near his feet, and other Swami sat outside holding the rod in the truck, you know, outside. So, but you know, I shall never forget. We are so much worried about returning to the city, and this Swami, he was 78 years old, standing in the, on the Himalayan, say, rock, you know, peak, unparted. Cold wind was blowing, very cold. Stood there, motionless. I thought that, you know, when Krishna mentioned in the Gita, sign of his sthita prajna, man of a steady wisdom, unshaky, unparted. Stood there, have deep faith in God. I shall never forget. But at the same time, then, do you know what I went to the temple when Pushupatinath? We are VIPs. All visitors are out. We saw that Shiva. That Shiva is very unusual. 5 heads, 4 directions, and the top there is head in Pushupatinath in Nepal. Because we are royal, is a visit. So what happened, after the visit, I saw he went outside in the compound, on the step. He sat and took his hand there and was repeating his mantra. We learned that when you visit a temple, in temple there is very busy. The pilgrims will push you out. You cannot stand there long. Then, whatever you saw inside the temple, that you try to visualize sitting outside. Don't go away. At least 15, 20 minutes you must sit. That, you know, if you live with these holy people and how they live, you can learn a lot of things from them. Then, do you know what happened while returning? We returned from Indian Airlines. And the airline, they served vegetable chop and coffee. So I took coffee, and Swami took vegetable chop and coffee. The vegetable chop was cold. He ate it and then came back to the ashrama in Kankurgachi, and his stomach was upset. So I called him from Adyajasa, I said, Maharaj, I hear that your stomach is upset. Why did you eat that cold vegetable chop? Perhaps it may cause food poisoning. Sometimes old food in the airlines. Then he told me, you are responsible for my sickness. Uncle, why? You know my child nature, whatever people give, I eat. Why did you not take away the vegetable chop from my hand? You are supposed to snatch away the vegetable chop from my hand. I go, it is very difficult to go with this kind of monks. You know? When I went, I had 35 questions. Some places I couldn't understand the gospel of Ramakrishna in Bengali. Those Bengali, Sri Ramakrishna's Bengali is different than our part of Bengali. The colloquial, some words we couldn't follow. So I went there and I said, Maharaj, it is in Biryodharanyaka Upanishad, Gargi told Yajnavalkya, I shall throw two arrows on you, answer. Arrows means questions. So I told Maharaj, I shall throw 35 arrows on you. 35 arrows I shall throw on you. You bring all of your arrows, I shall break one after another. He was very, very learned Swami. Then on 15th September 1978, he wrote me a letter. You know, I went to Amarnath, the ice cave in the Himalayas. Swamiji went. I had a desire, so I went. Doctor was with me. I had angina problem. They carried oxygen cylinder for me. Doctor, everything was with me. So I went. Everybody, Swamiji had experience. Everybody has experience. I had also experience. But what was the experience? Heart attack experience. That is my experience. Heart attack. That is experience, you see. He lived in Kankurgachi Jogoddan. It is in the east part of Calcutta. You cannot believe any afternoon. People flocked just to see him and be with him for an hour and a half. After his walk, he used to come and sit on the courtyard. Hundreds of people. People ask questions and he would answer. Every Sunday, he used to give a class. And those classes came in book form. And I used to supply cassette tapes. They used to record, and then they used to transcribe, and then made books. Thus, they made 7 volumes of the gospel. And on Katha Upanishad, Munjuk Upanishad, Bhagavatam, just came from his talk. Then when, in 1989, he became the president, came to Belur Math. So in 1990, when I went to India, I said, Maharaj, you have become a president, so to make you a president, it is a big loss for us. So he was looking at me. Why? I said, because you did not finish the Gospel of Ramakrishna. There are 5 volumes. He finished, I think, 3 or 4 volumes. Whole gospel has not been discussed. You are right. Now I have become president. I cannot give classes. They put me there here. Then he said, do you know why I'm talking about that gospel? Many people explain the gospel of Ramakrishna, but nobody like him. He discussed the gospel from the standpoint of the scriptures. He interpreted the gospels. It is, now I think 2 volumes have come out in English. It is really eye-opening for the gospel. Those who read the gospel of Ramakrishna, it should be eye-opening for them. What a great mystery is hidden in this gospel of Ramakrishna from the Vedantic standpoint. Amazing person. When I started to give initiation, I remember I had so many questions. He trained me. Uncle, could you teach me that what is this? He taught me. Very few Swamis like him. Very traditional monks. And he knows this mantra shastra, the mantra scripture. I remember 16th March 1998. He died in September. I sent 42 questions to him. Please answer these questions and let your secretary record. Then it will be a book, so that in the future, people who have questions about initiation and mantra and japam and all those things, they will get correct and authoritative answers. Please answer. So his secretary said, all right, we shall put these things, but let us see. So it did not work out. Later on, he became very sick. In 1982, I went to Japan. So Swami, he had hundreds of devotees in Japan. He initiated the Japanese. So many Japanese followed him. And he used to talk, and Mrs. Nakai-san, one old lady, she used to translate what Maharaj said into Japanese. If you see their lives, how he transformed hundreds of people in Japan. Then he said, we am sorry that we have not yet be able to, we had the center, but not monks, it was not affiliated. But in 1984, it was affiliated, now we have monks there. Then in 86, when I went, he was very happy to see me. Then in Kakulgachi, he said, you will have to stay here for 3 days. I told him, no, don't you know? The police commissioner is my disciple. I shall keep you here under house arrest. I told him, Maharaj, only one day. And I saw Jano Samudra. Many ocean of human heads on Janmashtami Day in Kankurgachi. I told him, this monk may get heart attack. So many people. Just to see him. Then in 1988, we invited him. That was our golden jubilee of the Vedanta Society. We sponsored that Swami to come to America. First, from the Japan, he came to Los Angeles. I went to the airport to receive him. Then he was in Los Angeles. He visited all the centers. He came here too. Then what happened? In Tupugama, Swami went to see Disneyland. And the person who drove, he parked the car somewhere and could not locate the car. It is a car, ocean of cars. If you do not write down which row and where, you will be lost. So nearly after 2-3 hours, the Swami was standing. Where are the car? Krishnananda at last found the car and brought after 2-3 hours. His lecture is at 5 o'clock. He arrived at 4. Then hurriedly he ate something, came to the lecture hall. I am supposed to introduce him, because other Swami, head Swami was not well. So I introduced, here is a monk. Holy Mother said, ivory is very precious. And if that ivory is covered with gold, it becomes more precious. So here is a monk, highly spiritual. At the same time, very learned. So when I introduced that way, then he was talking to the devotees. Well, Chetanananda, he was a little hard of hearing. Chetanananda introduced me, ivory is covered with coal. I told gold, he heard coal. Ivory is covered with coal because ivory means my bone is white, but my body complexion is dark. So Chetanananda said coal. I was a little embarrassed. Anyhow, when the lecture was over, I went to his room. You embarrassed me in front of everybody. I said, coal, gold, and you heard coal. Then, did I say that? I claim you did. Then he was laughing. Sanjan never forget gold and coal. We took him to our basilica. We took him to the arch, then the confluence. Then Swami, 15th September, 16th September 7th, 3 days he gave talks here. He told his reminiscences of the Jari disciples, and on Sanjay he gave a lecture on what is Vedanta. We have videotaped them, so we have all those precious things here. Later, I told Maharaj, "Maharaj, do you know what? Bale, what? We are now selling you and making money." Bale, how do you make money for selling me? I said, "We are selling your tapes. That is how you are making money." He laughed. He was very fond of yogurt, sweet yogurt. So I wanted to make some yogurt for him. I boiled milk and put sugar, and then put a Dunkin' that sour, that yogurt I put, so that the yogurt will settle overnight. Woman, next morning, yogurt did not settle. Then I put into the oven, gave a little heat, because the American yogurt is not sour enough, you know, to make the curd right. So during last time, I told Maharaj, "My yogurt has become geography." "What do you mean?" "The world, two-thirds water, ocean, one-third land. So my yogurt has become two-thirds liquid, one-third solid. Only bottom portion solid and two-thirds liquid, milk only." "All right, you bring whatever you make." So from the bottom, I took a little and gave them. "It is very tasty. It must be tasty. Highly boiled milk and then sugar, it must be tasty." So he ate it. But next day, Mrs. Bhattacharya made sweet, very good card and gave to him. Then I said, "Maharaj, in St. Louis, we shall show you the greatest show on the earth." "Whatever you will show me. I have seen so many things in my life." "No, you have never seen these things." Then I told our Mary Butler, our secretary, "You go and buy the best tickets." Burnham Mary Circus was going on in Arena. "You buy the best tickets." So Mary went and bought 4 tickets, one for me and one for our driver and one Nitya Swami and Swami's secretary. So we went, it's a 3-ring circus. We get a little bit, 3-4 gallery up so that we can see all 3 rings. After half an hour, after half when intermission, he said, "Let us go home. Let us go to the ashram." I tell him, "We bought expensive ticket, and now you say go home." "Then enough. You go, let us go home." But he did not say why he wanted to go. But he did not like that girls, you know, in trapeze moving around with little dress. But so he came back. Then he has a little heart problem. Then a Dr. Gupta, Jiten, took him to his office and has a echocardiogram. Then do you know what? After many years, when I went to India, he said, "You know, I visited many centers in America, but in St. Louis, I felt I have come home. Perhaps it is for you. Maharaj, it is our great privilege that we could serve you. But do you like to go back to America again? We shall give you 9 kinds of fruits during breakfast table. Why not 10 kinds?" I'm going, "All right, 10 kinds of fruits." But then, no, that time it is God's master's grace that I could go to America. A great Swami. In 1990, I was robbed in an ashrama. They took away my watch, my 1,000 rupees, and then the news spread. Wherever I go, everybody gives me 1,000 rupees. Then I came to Belur Mart. Then Swami said, "You lost watch? Hey, bring all my watches." See, he got so many gifts. So I remember he put a Seiko watch on my and charged it. He asked his secretary, take a picture. That I gave a watch to him. Just like a child, a person. No ego. You can feel it. He was a linguist. He knew English, Bengali, Sanskrit, Hindi, Gujarati, then some tribal languages. So one day we had a debate. Uncle, do you know how sound changes the meaning? Sound changes the meaning. Same word one can use, it meaning changes. How? A little boy wants to go to school and asking mother, mother, am I going to school? Mother says, jao. Jao means I'm giving you permission. Jao, go. Suppose a thief or a bad person entered the room, same mother is shouting, jao! Money, get out. Same word, but tone, the voice changes. Perhaps here is a lover and the beloved wants to leave, lover is pushing, jao! Jao means don't go. Jao! Push. Same word, one is permission, one is get out, another is don't go. Same word, meaning changes according to the bhanu, sound. We had a wonderful time. Sometimes intentionally I used to make mistake quoting the scripture. Durastas chakrat. Hey, you made a mistake. It is from Raghuvamsham, from a verse Lakshmana was showing Sita. The Duradas chakra tvannivasya tvannitamalo tali vanaraji nila abhati vela labanamburase dhari nivaddhiva kalunkarekha. You know, we read again and again, again and again. In his room, not many books. But once he reads, he never forgets. Fantastic. And sometimes we quote. Sometimes our quotation sometimes have mistakes, but his quotation does not have any mistake. He knows grammar. And the Bhagavatam, Gita, Upanishad, they burst out from his lips like fireworks. Spontaneously they come. Amazing person. I used to tease him, Maharaj, you without preparation, how beautifully you speak in the lecture. And we prepare and prepare and prepare. His thoughts are so arranged, very logically, he would speak. When I used to come to America, he used to ask, take my clothes. He gets so many dhotis and other clothes. Do not buy. Don't misuse master's money. The devotees during initiation gave me clothes, chador, take those things. Very, very thoughtful person. 1st August 1890, I went to say goodbye. I can say goodbye. Come again. May Sri Ramakrishna be with you. Holy Mother be with you. May Swamiji be with you. Then it was in 1993. There was a huge parliament in Calcutta, Swamiji's 100 years of America, Chicago parliament. So I was invited to speak. So he read the paper. Uncle Maharaj, you never read the paper. You speak spontaneously. He said, you know, after my open heart surgery, my body has become a little weak, and they gave a limited time. So I want to tell the important things in that limited time. That is the reason I read the paper. In 1996, 1st January, we are in San Francisco. Some nuns got their final vows. So during the breakfast table, one nun asked, we are 10 monks are there. So they asked question, what are the most essential things in monastic life? That was the question to each monk. And each monk spoke differently. So I went to India and asked Maharaj. Then I was from San Francisco, I went to Japan. In Tokyo, I had a lecture there. Then I said, Maharaj, you know, same question, 10 monks gave 10 answers. I like to hear your answer. Then he said, tell me what those 10 monks said. So I quoted some. Then he said, combine them, that is my answer. Some said renunciation and purity, some God realization, some longing and austerity, some said Ramakrishna Vivekananda and ideal, some said karma yoga. I said, Maharaj, sometimes in the West people ask that we have not seen God, how can I love him? If I see a person, I can love. But I have not seen you, how can I love you? Then he said, don't you love your Atman? Everybody loves his Atman, self. That very self is God. Love God, which is within you. I remember it was in, I carried some pecan pies for Swami and some other staff from America. At 3:30 I went to his room and he was drinking tea. Gala, Maharaj, I brought something from India, from America, but I'm afraid to give to you. Why? If you eat and you, if you be sick, your doctors will blame me. You know? You go to the monk's quarter and bring one thing hiding, and I shall eat it, nobody will be able to know. So I ran to the monk's quarter and brought that package, hiding with my chador, a big pecan sandwich. Then I gave one, and he put into the tea and took it. And then I read the ingredients. I said, no, Maharaj, there is nothing wrong, you know, low fat and all those conditions are there. Oh, is that so? Just see, you are trying to deprive me from pecan sandwiches. He called his attendant, hey, every afternoon, give me pecan sandwiches. I shall never. Very funny. We had many spiritual questions. Many scriptural questions. One day he was not well. So his secretary said, don't allow him to talk, you talk. So I said, Maharaj, let me tell you a convent story. He was a great storyteller. So that day I became a storyteller. A nun joined, she was very complaining. Mother Superior said, every 10 years, you are supposed to speak 2 words. So 10 years passed. The nun went and said, food, bad. After 10 years, very tired. So after 10 years, means after 30 years, she said, I quit. That is a convent joke. And he laughed. There are many things I can say. I do not have too much time. One day I was telling Maharaj, you know, I saw you in 1960, and after 35 years, you look same. I do not see any change in your face and your body. Oh, do you know the story of the same? I don't know. There's an Englishman. He 80 years old, 20 years When he was 20 years, he was in Oxford University. So he went to dormitory and wanted to see the room where he stayed 60 years ago, just curiosity. So he knocked at the door, a young man came out, may I help you? You know, he explained that why he had come to visit that room. Come in, please come in. Then he was in same old room, same old furniture. Then he went through the window, same old view. Then he opened the closet, a young girl came out. Then this boy said, oh, she is my sister. The same old story. The same old story. He was full of fun. I have so many stories to tell you, but you don't know. I was telling him, Maharaj, when I was a college student in Calcutta, during Durga Puja with the microphone, they would say, if you visit a deity, you must offer something. Pranam kulle, punami dite hai. Otherwise, your visit will not be perfect. So I told these things. Then he was saying, you are visiting me, what are you offering to me? I gave my head to him. I'm Maharaj, my head, I am giving to you. So he rubbed my head. We are talking about, you know, that it is a scriptural question that if you get knowledge of Brahman, you will be liberated. But some Hindus believe that if you die in Banaras, you will be liberated. So I told one monk, Maharaj, how is it possible? Then that monk in Banaras, he scolded me. We old people are waiting here to die, and you young man, you have come here to confuse us. He scolded me right and left, you know. I said, Maharaj, scripture says so, and it is your belief. What shall I take? Which one shall I take? Then he said, we are both correct. Uncle, how? But Lord Shiva will give me knowledge at the last moment. So we'll be all liberated. You will not have to worry for us. Then Swami said, there was a monk, he said, if I have that faith, I would go there and commit suicide. If Banaras, if you die in Banaras, if you get liberation, you will commit suicide. I asked many, many scriptural questions. I have no time to tell you all those things, but one story I told, when I was leaving, I said, Maharaj, what type of guru you are? Can you, Sri Ramakrishna said, there are three kinds of physicians. One physician, just give a prescription, take the medicine. He does not inquire whether patient took that medicine or not. Second, the doctor will call, hello, are you taking medicine? How are you doing? That is second kind of doctor. A third kind of doctor, if you do not take medicine, he will put his knee on your chest and force you to take the medicine. That is uttam vaidya. So Maharaj, what kind of doctor you are? You know, can you put your knee on the chest of your disciple and give the knowledge of Brahman? So when he bolen, amato dui hatutei betha. I have pain in both knees. I have pain in both knees. I cannot put my knee on the chest of my disciple. He was full of fun. Very pure character. And he knows the scripture so well. One question I asked, Maharaj, what do you see the future? But do you know what? A monk's life should be full of renunciation and purity. Wealth will come, but too much wealth brings luxury, comfort, that will stop your growth. Poverty is much better in monastic life. Then he says, Ushurjo sarbanash dekehane. Too much affluence will bring the growth of the spiritual life. You know, he was a very... But did you see your guru angry one day? But one day I saw my guru's shout, long, loud voice. When? When Holy Mother's body was cremated in Belur Math, after cremation, some devotees jumped and to pick up some relics, bones and ashes. At that time, Swami Sarodananda shouted, those who are taking these bones and ashes, they will have to worship every day. And if you do not do, that would be disaster in your life. Immediately, all the devotees dropped the bones and ashes. Then we picked up. We monks carried and put it in an urn and saved it. That we put it in the mother's temple. In Belur Math, you see, his bones, ashes are there. And that is the spot where her body was cremated. Anyhow, he used to tell us many, many, many stories. There are, I did not bring his humorous, there are so many humorous stories out there, I cannot tell you them. How he taught. Maybe in future I shall try another, his humors and the stories, how he trained the monks and helped them. I already passed my time. Thank you.
Bhadram karne vishrinu yama devaha Bhadram pashye bhaksha virja jatra Sthirairangaye sushtubhagum sastanuvi Vishima devahi tayyadayu Om shanti shanti shanti. May we hear with our ears what is auspicious. May we see with our eyes what is good. May we strong in limbs and body, sing your praise and enjoy the life allotted to us by you. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto all.